Eddie Jones is currently under a huge torrent of pressure from the fans, from the media, from anyone who will actually have a go at the moment. His methods and his validity are being questioned. Why hasn't he picked Paolo Odogwu when he's been ripping it up in the Premiership? Why hasn't he picked Sam Simmons, who's also been doing the same thing? And on top of that, if we picked those guys, could we have beaten Wales? Would that have worked if we'd picked the in-form players? To a certain extent, the pressure was on after the Scotland game, but Wales versus England really cranked it up a few notches. It was so controversial that the Welsh improvement in attack and defence totally overlooked in the first three post-match questions. Totally overlooked. There was controversy, that's what they were going for. And admittedly, this was very good play from Wales, and it wasn't even talked about, albeit in a very different fashion than it should have been. The comments after the game on Facebook, on The Guardian, they were pretty rife about the same thing. Ill-discipline, Wales deserved the win, and also the forbidden, unforeseen love story we never knew was coming. What do I do to make you want me? What have I gotta do to be heard? What do I say when it's all over? Sorry seems to be the hardest word. So sad. It's a sad, sad situation, and it's getting more and more absurd.
I couldn't resist. I'm sorry.
A joke. He made a joke.
This is the only time I'm going to mention Pascal Gauzère in this video. Simple fact is, we lost the game, England lost, and a lot of people blame the ref. We're rugby players. We don't blame the ref. That's a rugby value. The referee is respected. Get over it. England's ill-discipline was to blame. But the fact is, if we look past that, if we look past the ill-discipline, the penalties, the huge amount of drink that I actually had after the game, and the copious amounts of reflection that I had thereafter, prompted by the worst hangover I've ever had in about 3 weeks, I found myself very, very happy, cheery even, and that was what vexed me a little bit. Why, you may ask? Well, that's the question. See, we clearly have a problem with referee management, being able to manage our penalties, and also we're worst place in the table since 2018, where basically our complete lack of nous at the breakdown got us totally exposed. That's what happens when you start crock rolling with two-man pods. But the simple fact is we look nothing like the greatest of all-time team that Eddie Jones wants us to be, at the moment. What is exciting, however, is that the signs are there. In 2018, Ireland were the kings of the Northern Hemisphere, and England were fifth in the table and had clear problems with their game plan. Ireland were the kings, and we were fifth in the Six Nations table, which I believe is the lowest position we've ever been. However, the difference was, compared to then and now, is that we are now playing great rugby, and we're showing a great amount of potential. Great rugby, you say? Yeah, I know. Many people have called me laughable since talking about it, particularly the blokes on the WhatsApp group in my club. However, Eddie Jones is currently developing the attack. He has started an onus on the attack this year, and what we'd started to see is England's ball-in-hand attack they plan to take to 2023. And make no mistake, when this comes good, it is going to be magnificent. What Eddie has developed is ambitious, it is exciting, and quite frankly, when it comes good, it will be unstoppable. The man he enlisted to turn this around, Simon Amor, the England attack coach and England Sevens former attack coach. This guy is brilliant when it comes down to it, and he may have taken some elements from the Brian Ashton attack, or the Brian Ashton school of thought at the very least. Brian Ashton is arguably England's greatest rugby brain that we've ever developed. He has coached all around the world, preaching flair, creativity, and seamless ball-in-hand attack. Now, flair, creativity? That's not very English, you might be saying. Where did he actually get that? Where was he influenced? The answer is this guy, Pierre Villeprouve. Villeprouve is a French fly half who played for the Toulouse team of the late 60s, early 70s, and whom played along Brian Ashton, which is where Brian Ashton took the majority of his influence from. Villeprouve was Ashton's mentor. This is footage of his Benetton team in 1992 taking the ball forward. Just look at this. It is wonderful rugby. The alignments are perfect. The offloading, the handling, the willingness, the intent to attack and keep the ball moving, absolutely magnificent. His philosophies were so innovative at the time that they forever changed the direction of French rugby. All French teams started embracing the ball in hand offloading style of play. which is why he's known as the father of French flair. This is where it came from, Pierre Villeprou. Does anyone remember that magical French victory against the New Zealanders in 1999? Well, Villeprou was the head coach. Brian Ashton took from him because he was that good. If you look at the things on Brian Ashton's board here, there is not one thing about shape, structure, anything like that. It is all about basic skills and decision making. And that is because Pierre Villeprou always spouted the ethos that flexibility and adaptability are key, not organisation. Now this is something we can see in the France of 2020/2021, since Fabien Galthié took over. Fabien Galthié was the scrum half in 1999. We can actually see him here. He is the guy booting this ball. This results in a quite spectacular Frenchiest of the French try. He boots it off into space, is taken one-handed by Christophe Donomisi, who goes over the line and scores the try. Go well up there, big man. Go well. France's revival is down to Sean Edwards' defence and Galtier's willingness to take these principles and apply them to his own French team. The 50-50 passes being given, the offloading, the rapidity of the play, and this! I mean, look, what is this? There's not pods, there's no structure. Classic, begrudgingly wonderful French. Their intention isn't to use structure, it's to get the ball to the space. I mean, look at that. What we saw there wasn't really structure, but it got the ball over the line, and it's classic French play. I mean, if we need more evidence, look at this. Jalibert abandons a perfectly lovely shape to pass out to a lone Brice Doulin. And do you want to know why he did it? It was the right option. They go straight over for a try that they wouldn't have scored on the other side. Absolutely sublime play and classic Villeprou teachings. Why am I happy, however? Why does this apply to England? It's because Eddie Jones has realised that the unstructured part of this is necessary. And on top of that, Simon Amor has as well. That is why I'm this guy. And quite frankly, I want to show you why. Let's get into it. For those who don't know, this is Tony Brown, current Highlanders head coach and former Japan attack coach. He's responsible for the attack of the Japan 2019 rugby team, the attack that frilled and scintillated with offloads and rapid movement. It was magnificent play. Japan were the darlings of the 2019 World Cup, as they were the 2015 World Cup. They beat Ireland and Scotland, and they did it playing rapid, beautiful, inspired rugby. The rugby that they played in 2019 was a continuation of the rock and run approach developed by Eddie Jones in 2015. They did, however, develop a new shape, and this was the 1-3-2-2 system. That's where you got a free pod, a two pod, and then a further two pod of wing forwards, as we can see here. Now, whilst the Blossoms are very fond of the blindside run, the 1-3-2-2 allows them to stretch the opposition. With the rapidity of their quick ball, they're able to get the ball wide to the wing forwards who are very fast and make metres against very, very well-drilled defences. England clearly saw how good this was and decided to take it a little bit for themselves. I mean, tit for tat, all that kind of jazz. England have started employing the 1-3-2-2 system. Now, England operate this system. They can operate it with backs in or they can operate it with backs out. But regardless, it depends on Ford and Farrell or Ford and Slade in other cases to make sure that it works efficiently. Here, we can see the 1-3-2-2 with loaded backs. We have George Ford behind the free pod, we have Henry Slade behind the second two pod or the second carry pod, and then we have Elliot Daly at the third receiver behind the wing forward pod. This is a pretty standard attacking shape. We've got the backs actually taking the ball to the line, making sure they commit the drift defence as much as they can, but without the outside backs, they almost always use the forwards, and this is where the 10-12 or the 10-13 combination comes into play. On the return phase, we see George Ford take the ball behind the free pod and pass to the two pod, in this case Makovonopolo, who crashes it up. This has formed a split field pattern. We have the wing forward pod out wide as the last two option. However, if we look here, the backs still aren't fully in play yet, and as such, this is a dynamic we'll get into later. But as we can see, the entire England team are currently located within the 15 metre lines. From here, England can run off 9 or off 10 play. It really depends on George Ford. It depends on the position that he's pulled his backs into, how effective his forwards have been in crossing the gain line, and in particular where his backs are and where the options are to strike. However, this is just meant to show the 1-3-2-2 shape. England have variations, particularly in slow ball when they employ free pods to try and get the momentum back, especially when they're trying to get on the front foot. In this case, we have a 2-3-3 attack shape. Now, the ball goes out wide via the backs, but when they actually get there, they don't set into their standard shape. Instead, they set into a 1-2-3-2 attack shape. The one, or circled here, is Courtney Laws, whereas the two podders we're about to see is Carl Sinclair and Johnny Hill, circled in blue here. The ball goes to Ford, and it goes to Luke Cowan-Dickie, who breaks the line, and we see Billy Vunipola come in as the tip-on option in the free shape. Again, this forms a split field attack if England want it. However, they go same way, and we've got Maro Itoje and Tom Curry as the wing forwards out wide in the two pod. These variations are mainly down to slow ball or positional fluidity, in particular the way England want to attack under George Ford. Now, we'll look into a couple of things, namely when outside backs are in the ruck or have been used in a set-piece play, the 10-12 are key to wide play, and this is why Ford and Farrell are so vital in England's attacking system. Still, England target George North here off first phase scrum ball. Sladey manages to make a break in the 13 channel, and as we can see, we have all the backs bar Ford, Farrell and Slade operating around a 3-2 system. Therefore, they can't move the ball out wide. They have to go for the split field. England attempt to move the ball wide to exploit the space. However, the players there aren't backs and the alignment is all wrong, meaning the opportunity is shut down. Owen Farrell, however, shouldn't be here. He shouldn't be clearing out the ruck, and it costs England. If we have a look here, England are perfectly set for a wide attack, and if they do move the ball wide and Farrell is in his allotted position here, this is a run-in try. England's playmakers do have a habit of getting involved in the rucks in the wide channels, and that is something that does need to be corrected. But as Jamie George has said, England are playing good rugby. Next up, we're getting into the roles of the pods, what the 1-3-2-2 are actually intended to do, and their interdynamics. Now, we have to start off with a very common and controversial question, however. Why are certain players being picked and why are certain players not being picked? Why are the informed players being put to the side and why are the ones who really at the moment were really great but aren't playing as well, even though I think Billy did amazingly over the weekend, being picked over others who have been wowing, smashing the Premiership repeatedly for weeks and weeks and weeks and weeks and months and months and months on end? Well, it all comes down to their roles. Sam Simmons is a wing forward. He is an absolutely exceptional wing forward, and I love Sam Simmons. If I'm being perfectly honest, I'd have him in my team at flanker. I don't know exactly who would replace, because Tom Curry can't be dropped at the moment, but he should be at least in the 23. I mean, Jerome Kano thinks so. However, he's not in there. Billy is. So you have to wonder what is going on, and what England want from their eights. Well, that's what we're actually going to tell you right now, and what we're going to show you. If we really think about it, the eights who have been picked more than any other under Eddie Jones are big boys. Billy Vunipola, Nathan Hughes, that is the position, and that's because they fill very specific roles in the 1-3-2-2. England don't have a big backline, so they have to make up with it with monster carriers, and these are divided in the 1-3-2-2. Now we've got two carry pods in the 3 and the 2, and then we've got the wing forward pod. The 8 operates between the 3 and the 2, and so do all the rest of the power carriers. If we go back to the Italy game, we can have a look and see what exactly we mean by this. We've got Mako in the 3 pod, and then we've got Billy Vunipola in the 2 pod. Now the ball goes wide, as we know. It goes through the hands, and therefore England make quite a nice break. But on the return, we have to look at exactly what positions the forwards have taken up. On the return, it's Billy Vunipola in the 3 pod, whereas Mako is now in the 2 pod. They have essentially switched places. The reasoning behind this is because it spreads workload and ensures that both carry pods have power carriers within them. Now, in both of these examples, we can see that Billy does create space. He sucks in defenders, and this is the Billy effect. Personally, I think Billy has been pretty alright recently, but not many people do. But simply from reputation, we can see how many players he draws with every line he runs. I mean, look here. Against Wales, he was positioned in the backfield for the kick receipt. And look, three Welsh forwards have to be there to meet him, and he still goes forward. He still generates go forward against this many guys. We see it here also. The line from Billy actually draws Wyn Jones and George North in, which opens the seam for Owen Farrell, and he gets a great front foot option, meaning England are on the front foot. This is what Billy provides, not necessarily through form, but certainly through reputation. He at least draws in defenders. Even when the shit hits the fan, England can adapt. Here we have the carry pod consisting of the Vunipolas and the wing forward pod consisting of Maro Itoje and Courtney Laws. Now if we have a look here, Laws takes the ball forward and passes to Maro Itoje, but Laws gets taken out post-tackle. The Vunipolas were shaping up to form the new free pod, but upon seeing this they have to get in, they have to support Itoje, so the free pod has to be changed. Laws can no longer support Itoje, therefore the free pod is formed from the 2 pod, who have combined with Johnny Hill to get the ball out wide, and Fordy is lost no opportunity to get the ball wide into space. This focus on off-the-ball work is exactly what Eddie is trying to measure. These actions by the Vunipolas saved England here from turnover, and this is exactly what he wants to see. It's also what Simon Amor wants to see also, because the more off-the-ball work he sees, the happier he's going to be. And this is because fitness reasons. England are getting fit.
The fitter they get, they maintain that horrible threshold of where they're willing to work, but their fitness levels rise, but the threshold rises with it. So they just get through more work. That threshold never changes. They're always willing to push the boundaries. I don't know that many 15s players that are capable of getting into that level of zone.
Eddie Jones hired Simon Amor because he wants to see exactly where this England team can go. There is a huge focus, a huge onus on sevens fitness in this new system. There is a lot of running in sevens fitness, and as such, anabolically, it has a higher demand than union. Eddie Jones is very fond of referencing Roger Bannister, the first man to break the 4-minute mile, something everyone said was unachievable until we did it. This is the reference behind his greatest of all time quote. He wants to take England to a point that they've never been before. No rugby team has been before, and this is in terms of their fitness. If you're to think of the most attacking competition in the world, you're like to think of Super Rugby Rotorua, and rightly so. It is a fantastic competition. But if we have a look here, the average ruck speed for Super Rugby Rotorua is 2.76 seconds. 2.76. Remember that. Let's have a look now and see what England are doing. Okay, so we get the ball rolling at, let's have a look here, 1.92 seconds. Okay, that's not bad. That's not bad. Now, this option, 0.67 seconds. Okay, pretty good. Then the ball goes over. Yeah, try. All good, all good, all good. Okay, so if we have a look here, this is from kick receipt. We go to 1.58 seconds. Okay, here, this is good. Now, Johnny May goes for a roll here. He rolls, so we have to take that into account, but it's 2.21. That's still the slowest of the day. Still pretty good. This one is 1.67. Okay, as we can see, this is rapid ruck speed, and it's all intended to exhaust the opposition and to confuse them. This is essentially what Jones did with Japan. Play too fast for the opposition to even know what you're doing. In this case, we've got 1.75. That's okay, only okay by England standards. Here, we have a 0.63 seconds. Here, we have a roll, and also Sheedy nearly gets over, so it's 2.46, which is the slowest of the day. Still well under Super Rugby. In this case, we have 1.75 before the ball is moved wide. The England players all have to be in position for this ruck speed. They have to be quick enough to reposition to be ready for the ball when Ben Youngs delivers it. Ben Youngs, when he first met Eddie Jones, was told, oh, this. He was told this. I mean, that's the equivalent of someone following you around with a tuba. But they have to be that fit. They have to be fit enough to play the game that Jones and Amor want them to play. That is what we'll show you now. Now, I know that the Brian Ashton, Pierre Villeprou had a kind of really random feel about it. It may have been construed as slightly off topic, and you'd be right. But there's a reason why we included them, and that's because England have taken certain philosophies from them to use in 2021. Villeprou's motto and philosophy was to coach movement first. Movement happens the most in the game, therefore you coach movement. England have taken this principle and applied it with the midfield tip-on as the basis of one of their main attacking patterns. As we can see here, we have Ellis Genge at point with Carl Sinclair outside him for the tip-on option if it's called, and this is the way England are trying to split the field. We see it against Italy as well. Cowan Dickey makes the break with a great line, but Billy Vunipola is there for the tip-on or the offload if the option is on. And earlier on in the game, we see them execute it with Carl Sinclair tipping on to Maro Toje. The space has opened up in this channel here, and Maro calls it. So the ball goes from George Ford to Carl Sinclair, and Carl Sinclair puts in the pop pass to Maro Toje. Now, it doesn't work in this case. However, England go on to score the try anyways. They get the ball away, and Anthony Watson shows great footwork to go over the line and puts the ball down under the sticks. Continuing on from this is the use of the slide pattern. The slide pattern is one of England's patterns that they use to win the race against the opposition fold. We last saw it used by England in 2003, when the England team under Clive Woodward, employing the Brian Ashton attack philosophies, used it to win the World Cup. The principle is essentially very similar to an overload of one side of the field. Here, we have Will Greenwood and Josh Lucy circled in red. The pass from Greenwood goes to Wilkinson, and Wilkinson puts the flat pass to Martin Johnson on the line, who goes through, drawing in the outside All Black defenders. This means we have three All Black defenders on the far side, and Lucy and Greenwood are folded round simultaneously, meaning there is now an overlap because they folded round while the All Blacks have been brought in. This pattern demands extraordinary fitness, and it's essentially a way of moving the opposition round. This was done whilst England had 13 on the park and New Zealand had 15. They were still able to get an overlap, and shows the efficacy of the pattern. Against Ireland in 2003, Steve Thompson crashes up the midfield and England forwards fold round at a rate of knots, whereas only one Irishman folds over. This means you have more Englishmen going up against fewer Irishmen, and England make use of this to get on the front foot. This is similar to England 2021. However, England 21 do use a little bit more structure. England are in their 1-3-2-2 shape. The three are highlighted in blue, the backs are highlighted in yellow, and Marrow, the one, is highlighted in green. Now, we can see them run the two-pod option. Now, if we have a look here, we're going to pause the video. Look at what we can see. England have abandoned any chance of a blindside. The three-pod have moved round, Marrow's moved round, and the two backs have also moved round to present themselves as options, which is a dynamic we'll look into in a bit. But as we can see here, this pattern is based on overload. England had 15 players within the 15 metres. England run the two-pod option again, and as we can see, Billy, though available for the offload, isn't taken. However, when we come back out wide, we can actually see that both the wingers have moved over, as well as Mako Vinopola, to try and overload the Italians and give them too many options to cover. This is that effective because the slide incorporates reuse of the forwards coming round the corner. First phase here, Farrell crashes it up. Yet, let's pause it and have a look and see what we have next. We have Vinopola highlighted in red, and on the near side, Curry and Wilson. The ball goes under them, however, to Ford, who recycles the ball. Now, when the ball's presented back, it goes to Billy Vinopola, who folds round and takes the short ball to crash up the fringes. Here, however, we see Curry and Sinclair highlighted. On the next off-nine phase, guess who it goes to? It goes to Curry and Sinclair, who have folded round. Sinclair gets a great carry, presenting the ball quickly, and Ben Young's scoop commits Alan Wynne-Jones, which means that England go over for the try with a 5-on-3 overlap. This is created via the slide pattern. By sliding across faster than the opposition can fold, they gain numbers and therefore they gain this overlap, meaning it doesn't even have to be that structured. They can simply go over with flat alignment. Against Italy, we have Curry and Ewers highlighted in red, with Ewers actually being at the base of the previous ruck. In yellow, we have Malins, Daly and Watson all reloading round, as is expected in the slide pattern. The pod goes in, after which we have Curry and Ewers reloading round at the last second to take the ball, and they charge straight into the fringe, whereas the yellow, in Malins, Daly and Watson, have moved round to take the ball off Ford if he calls it. Against Wales, we have Sinclair, Curry and Ewers already reloading round. On the next option, they are all available for the short off-nine option. However, Ford calls it and the ball goes wide to Malins. On the reverse, the principle is the same, and this attests to the fitness of the England side. Now highlighted in yellow, we have Malins on the deck, Ford over him, and Watson. Now the free pod goes in. When the ball comes out, Robson shoots it to Ford, and Ford has both Watson and Malins available as options, with Watson actually being the intended strike runner in this case. It is essentially a swing system, a constant swing system where players are moving from one side of the field to the other to try and catch the opposition out. The switch pattern, however, is directly related to the slide pattern in that it's designed to take advantage of errors that evolve from reaction to the slide pattern. Again, in 2003, England would send a stack of forwards to the midfield. This would create a split field option, which means that the All Blacks would fold round to anticipate the slide pattern, at which point they would launch the switch. They would come back the same way that they'd actually come from, with a rapid first receiver. Sometimes it worked and sometimes it didn't. Yet if we look here, Robinson's highlighted in red. Now he's the switch option. McCaw folds round to anticipate the slide. However, this is a mistake. This is the trigger for Robinson to come through on the switch pattern. He does, and because McCaw is out of position, Robinson gets through when McCaw's meant to be guarding. It involves switching with a rapid first receiver, targeting any error in the overfold of the forwards around the ruck. Ireland under Joe Schmidt were masters at this. They run a 2-1 pattern, and on the second phase, they're anticipating Joe Launchbury folding around the side of the ruck. They make an effort to push him out of the way. This means he's not there at pillar, and Carney has a clean run to the line on the inside ball. It's a very simple, yet a very effective tactic. Because Launchbury was meant to be here, Marnie pushes him over to the other side of the ruck. Because he sat down, and because he can't get round to the other side of the ruck because of Paul O'Connell stopping him, he can't get round to stop Carney's line, resulting in the try. Unfortunately, a year later, Australia borrowed from Ireland to actually exploit this same weakness to wicked effect. The 2-1 pattern is run, and on the second phase, we can actually see Launchbury fold around to the other side of the ruck. This results in Ben Youngs being isolated. Joel Launchbury can't fold back around in time, and Kirtley Beale goes straight through the pillar, passing back to Bernard Foley, who goes over for a quite simply beautiful try. Eddie Jones wants this dynamic in his England team. Already, there have been times when it would have proven very, very, very useful if England had played heads up and realised it was on. However, it wasn't taken. We have already seen the intent from England. Here, Ben Youngs has the option to pass to Anthony Watson coming through with Elliot Daly, using Mako Vunipola and Johnny Hill as a screen to target these channels. This is classic England 03. Target the fold over with a rapid change of direction from a first receiver, and therefore you have a winger against forwards and an underman line, an absolute classic mismatch. Eddie wants a dynamic to target these gaps, and this is what has been developed for, to target the overfold, and therefore target gaps that may appear that the defence don't expect you to take. The same principle off 10 works with catch and pass, where Slade nearly gets through the 13 channel. However, most of the time, this tactic is run off Ben Youngs. This is where you have a forward coming in off a flat pass off Youngs to try and exploit the overfold of a position, as was shown here with Johnny Hill in slow motion. Now, if we see this in real time, we can see what's going on. Look, Johnny Hill is repeatedly running back towards this gap here, expecting the pass from Ben Youngs. Hill also tries it against Sitterly as well. Ben Youngs, we can see here, he has a little look up, but there. That was the option. That was the option, however, he doesn't pick it. There are times that it does work. There's no throw by Ireland, and Ty Crelong folds around the ruck. Now this puts Maro Toje in a very favourable position. He goes straight through because Furlong is out of the game and goes under for the try. That is what Eddie Jones is trying to do. He also does it with his wingers as well. Admittedly, Wales nailed it, but it's not always going to be nailed. And that is exactly what Eddie Jones is counting on. Eddie's overall plan is to get England attacking anywhere on the field, anyway, within two phases. Even one, if he has enough time and the speed is right. The only way they can do this is with off-the-ball work, rapid off-the-ball work, which takes us through to the reload dynamics. Paolo Odogwu is a powerful, powerful X-factor player. He is a game-breaker. He makes terrific line breaks. He's got great acceleration. He's like a mix between Jason Robinson and the Hulk. He is just that kind of player. However, this bodes the question, why isn't Eddie picking him? The comments on the forums, on Facebook, on social media, they're all asking the same question. Why aren't we picking the informed players? Why we're not picking Paolo, however, is quite simple. Eddie's already kind of told us. Let's hear what he has to say.
Bring something to the attack, and Paolo's... Yeah, I remember watching him when Steve Dom was a director of rugby at Sale, and he was a powerful guy, but maybe a little bit lazy. And now, whilst he's had a bit more game time, found his feet a bit more, he's got fantastic power, you know, ability to beat people, ability to find the line, and a great enthusiasm for the game, which is so important.
Eddie gave it away there. He said exactly why he's not picking him. It doesn't take Sherlock to work this out. It's not exactly what is said, but it's a byproduct of what's inferred. Let's have a listen again.
Paolo's, yeah, I remember watching him when Steve Dom was a director of rugby at Sale, and he was a powerful guy, but maybe a little bit lazy, maybe a little bit lazy, a little bit lazy, a little bit lazy, a little bit lazy, 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 lazy.
Now, there is no way that Eddie Jones thinks Paolo is lazy right now. He would not be anywhere near the squad if he thought that. However, there is something that Coach Carter once said, Coach Carter the film, that really emphasizes why.
Now, I cannot teach you the game of basketball until your conditioning is at a level that allows me to do so. Gentlemen, report to the baseline. To the baseline!
Under Simon Amor, the England players have to be near superhuman in terms of their fitness. It is absolutely insane. They have reload demand, and the reload demand of the greatest height and intensity is placed on the 11 and the 14, seconded by the 10 and the 12. Paolo Odogwu is going to be an England great. He is literally Jason Robinson mixed with the Hulk. He has the acceleration, the speed, the step, the ability to find the line. He has it all. However, Test rugby is a very different animal from club rugby. Imagine what would happen if Jones put him in and he wasn't physically conditioned for the game. The confidence shaker. England's wingers has spent years working under Jones to be prepared for England's intensity of the game. Odogwu has just come in. He doesn't have this, which is why we look at the reloading winger, the plus one strike weapon, and the ways that they target. This will explain why he's not there yet, but he will be. In 2018, in the summer tour, England scored a very league-style try against South Africa, with Johnny May coming in late at the line. This is what Simon Amor is trying to incorporate on a more regular basis. If we look at how this happened, Ford is marked. He is marked by Am, the 13 has him covered. However, if we look here, the 14 is covering Slade, so therefore no one is covering Johnny May. This means Johnny May just has to take the ball flat off Ford, go straight through, commit the last defender, and then put Daly over for the try. It's textbook, and it's exactly what happens. Here, we see Johnny May in the backfield next to Billy Vunipola. Billy Vunipola takes the ball forward to the crash option. Now May, on the other hand, starts his movement over in the slide pattern. Quick ball is generated and Sinclair takes the pop pass from Ben Youngs. He goes in and then the ball is recycled again. However, when the ball goes out, Johnny May is moved over behind Slade to strike the 13 channel, exactly the way that he did against South Africa. At the last second, however, he changes his line. Now we have two wingers on one side of the field, but why did Johnny change his line? If we look at the English two pod, they actually target the transition zone and check the Welsh drift defence, opening the hole for Johnny May here. If May took it, he's straight through. And this shows what England are trying to do, as it is a great, great option. But what this doesn't hide, however, is the work rate of England's wingers. They had two wingers on one side of the field, but what they were doing is they were doing it in such a way that Johnny May could reload. And as we see here, he reloads, so he is an option on the phase after the one that he was decked on the floor. He moves over with such intensity that he is that league option a phase after the one that he was decked. And that is absolutely unbelievable work rate. And it takes extraordinary fitness to do this. The main reason that England's wingers reload with this speed is to beat the reloading defenders in multi-phase. The reloading defender is the principle by which a back moves from one edge of the field to the other to cover any overlap that may be generated in the phases across field. This is shown by Jack Goodhue just barely getting through to shut the 13 channel down. Most defensive systems use this principle. The world champion Springboks utilise it also. They rely on the standard opposition free pod carry to slow the ball down, therefore buying the time for their defenders to get into place to cover any overlap that may have been generated. This covers the overlap generated by Wales, and against Scotland in the same autumn is used where Jesse Creel folding around behind the line, the Bok forwards slow the ball down, which buys the time for the new edge, the free edge, to set. Eddie Jones has a very cunning plan, however, to take out the reloaders and therefore get his wings round the corner to strike undefended channels. The way that they're employing this is the similar method taken from the England 2003 slide pattern. So if we look at this, how would this work today? We've got the line break that happens off Martin Johnson, yet the backs have folded round to create an overlap. So tell me, how would it work? The answer is actually pretty simple. It's from England's use of their tip-on off George Ford. That is the way they're planning to take out the reloading defenders. Now let's say Marrow gets to around here off the tip-on, if it goes through, and all goes hunky-dory. Now the reloading defender's role changes. He has to tackle Marrow. He has to take out the initial threat. Now this causes a problem because the reloading defender wants to be going all the way around here. He wants to be getting to about here to plug the 13 channel. And if he can't, that means he's going to be committed here. That means that England's backs, highlighted here in yellow, are going to be getting round and he is not going to be in position to stop them. Callum Sheedy performed this role admirably against England. Here, we see him highlighted in gold. Now look at his motions. He starts his movement behind the line. Now at this point, England are in a really good position if they had a couple of things different, because they want to be targeting these channels. They want to target these channels, best chance of making a break, best chance Sheedy's going to have to tackle the carrier. The two pod are the only ones that can do that, however. So when it goes through to the free pod, the opportunity is kind of lost. Sheedy keeps moving behind the line, which means on second phase, Ford tries to put Farrell into the gap that Sheedy has just come in to cover. That gap was on if Sheedy had been taken out, but he hadn't been. So therefore, we got to look. What could have changed that outcome? The first problem is the repeat of the Farrell conundrum in the wide channels earlier. Ford is currently in the ruck. Sheedy's here. Ford is here. That means he's not in his right position, which should be here. If he's there, he can take the pullback pass off the point, put his two pod into these channels and increase the chances of Callum Sheedy having to make a tackle through a line break. If he makes that tackle, that means he's not there to plug the hole on the next phase, meaning this pass is on. Ford can take the ball straight to the line to Tips and put Farrell straight through this gap, or throw a missed pass to Earls, which is a prime opportunity. It's actually a pretty simple sequence, but the addition of the tip-on, especially off Ford in this area, as we're about to show you, is the main reason why I believe this is intended to target out the reloading defenders, because by taking these guys out, England can disrupt decision-making in the defence. They gain numbers against an area which no longer has that cover, and it just makes total sense to do that. Now, we need to look at the options that George Ford creates. George Ford, 40. I've been defending George Ford on YouTube and Facebook forums longer than I care to admit. Years. He is a master player, and as a 10, is unrivaled in this world for me. If you want more details, Squidge did a sensational video on him that I couldn't recommend more that you watch. For me, 40 is literally like what would happen if you gave a brilliant 10 tutelage from Ra's al Ghul. You know, always mind your surroundings. Ford has an absolutely outstanding feel for the game. He knows how to run the attack, but his real gift is the ability and the choice of pass right at the line. Not many players do that better than him, if any. I can't think of anyone else who can. Ford's ability to take the ball flat behind the free pod is key to the way England want to play, because they pass through the pod to give Ford as much chance as they can. Ford has the option to split the pod to receive the pass in between the point and the inside attackers in the wedge, and this is a key reason why he can take the ball so flat. If he receives it underneath the free pod, he's way too deep and the outside defence can read it easy. By passing through the pod, it's much less obvious to the defence where the ball is going to end up, and they have to hold in case it hits the inside free pod. It may look simple, but what it simply does is affords Ford just a little bit of time to consider the options and to pass to the right option at the line, giving them the best chance in the two pod of making the break. Because he keeps it so flat as well, it also commits defenders. This is something that he's generally been doing constantly, ball in two hands, attempting to draw in defenders to put Farrell and his runners into gaps, and is something that Amor has clearly asked of him. If we look at him against Wales, he takes the pass behind the free pod and takes the ball right into the face of Josh Navidi, making sure to commit him. It's these little things that add up. I mean, the break here wasn't just because of that, it was also because of Billy's line. But if we have a look here, he does the exact same thing to Tips, attempting to commit him to put Owen Farrell through the gap that Callum Sheedy rightly shut down in the reloading defender role. Even if this doesn't result in breaks, it usually results in one-on-one tackles, which, against a guy like Billy, results in momentum and initiative for the next phase. This has, however, changed Farrell's role, albeit a little bit. Farrell is now playing a centre far more than he was in the previous years. He actually now takes the crash-up options far more than he did, but more importantly, not just in set piece, but in phase play. We're seeing Farrell getting into pods of two along with another forward, but the key thing that he's starting to do is the late swing off Ford. Now, this is a dynamic that England have really started doing, and it's something that we're going to talk through in a little bit of detail, because what it allows is it allows Farrell to choose his line and therefore target where the attack is actually going. Farrell has a couple of options here, but mainly he's not behind the two pod. Now, if he's a late entry into the two pod, the defence out wide are therefore going to have to readjust. If, however, he arcs his run to go in between the three and two pod, this allows him to target the seam, which is exactly what he did against Wales. Here, we have the late swing, with Farrell characterised by being directly behind Ford. Now, Ford takes the ball flat to Navidi. Now, here's the kicker. By committing Navidi, he doesn't allow Navidi to go out and target Vunipola. Vunipola's line has committed Wynne Jones and George North, and unfortunately Thomas Francis has two to pick from, Farrell and Slade. This means the passback option to Farrell puts him through the seam as George North hasn't committed over to help. Farrell's position behind Ford here is very, very crucial to his late decision-making ability. He can either come in very late behind Ford and take the pass off his shoulder, targeting the seam, or he can go behind the two pod, allowing the ball to be moved out wide. This is what his starting position here allows. Remember, especially in open play, this allows Farrell to operate more like a centre. He is a very good runner, Farrell. He's not really rated for it, but he is very good at it. If Sheedy hadn't plugged the hole in the reload, this line from Farrell could put Wales in a lot of trouble. This is very good news for Eddie Jones. Ford Farrell have been playing together since under 20s. They have a near telepathic understanding, and therefore, even though we can see the late swing here, Farrell changes his line. He can either go here to target the seam, or he can actually change it. He can go round behind the two pod to actually allow the ball to go wide, pushing out Henry Slade. But because he's not already set behind the two pod, the defence have no idea what he's going to do until the last second, meaning whatever option he picks, the defence are not going to be fully prepared for it. And that is what Farrell is started to do. When you add all of this together, the fitness, the speed, the repositioning, the late swing, absolutely everything, it means that within modern shape, you can attack anywhere within one phase using the slide and the switch pattern. And that is exactly what Eddie Jones is trying to do, recreate Roger Bannister's run, but in rugby form. This is why, as an England fan, I'm this happy. This is a brilliant, innovative attack. It has got potential, and yet it is still very much in his infancy. Eddie Jones knows what he's doing. He said we are heading in the right direction after the Wales game, and that's because we saw some improvement along these lines. You have to keep in mind that Eddie doesn't want this peaking until 2023. He doesn't want it peaking until then. I mean, this is still in his infancy, and yet when it got going, it looked bloody good. Fast, rapid, massive late repositioning, exactly what England wants. And this is by no means the finished article. There was so much in these games that I haven't touched on, it's untrue. You know, there was tons left out. There was things about the wingers coming in at first receiver, special loop plays to target the transition zone, using both wingers at the base of the ruck. There was so, so much. However, Amor has done a brilliant job in creating this. The comments are currently cruel, and it's understandable. We are not that happy with England's position in the Six Nations table. However, when it comes to their growth and the way and the direction that they're going, that is what is to be focused on, and that is where England are looking good. It doesn't look good in the papers. The media does not make it look good. That's what their job is, to sell headlines. But put everything together that Eddie Jones has created, and it is going to be incredibly hard to stop, and it's going to be incredibly, incredibly exciting to watch.